93 days until Halloween, and last night I watched In the Mouth of Madness. Now I'm going to talk about it.
I'm not insane!
Do you read Sutter Kane?
Where do you live?
With you.
Who takes care of you?
You do. You're my mommy. Know what today is? Today is mommy's day.
In the Mouth of Madness, number 3 in John Carpenter's Apocalypse Trilogy, preceded by The Thing and Prince of Darkness. Okay, this movie is mad underrated.
Released in 1994 and shot on a budget of a little over $10 million with a 36-day shoot, directed by John Carpenter and written by Michael De Luca, it stars Sam Neill as John Trent, a freelance insurance investigator who is hired by Jackson Harglow, played by Charlton Heston, a publishing director who tasks Trent with investigating the disappearance of popular horror novelist Sutter Kane, played by Jürgen Prochnow, a.k.a. Baron Wolfgang von Wolfhausen from Beerfest. Kane's editor, played by Julie Carmen, tells him that Kane's novels have been known to cause disorientation, memory loss, and paranoia in less stable readers.
Now, the first half of this film is near perfect. I mean, classic Carpenter, and its slow build to uncertain terror.
The movie begins with Trent in an insane asylum about to recount his story.
So it's told loosely from his perspective. This film has those eerie and slightly uncomfortable undertones that Carpenter's films are kind of known for.
But matched with a creepy kind of confusion you would find in a Twilight Zone episode or a Stephen King novel, who is mentioned by name in the film but is an obvious inspiration for the character Sutter Kane, who I might add is good friends with Carpenter as they work together on the movie Christine.
Both Carpenter and De Luca drew heavily from horror writer H.P. Lovecraft. In fact, some would say this is the most Lovecraftian non-Lovecraft film ever made.
Lovecraft's novel, At the Mountains of Madness, serves as an almost foundation to the story. The creatures from the Gulf of the Unknown, called the Old Ones, and the many references to the great squid-like tentacle monsters are all very much drawn from Lovecraft as well.
I mean, H.P. Lovecraft and his writings play a huge influence on the horror genre, even though the dude was really kind of messed up.
Carpenter himself grew up reading Lovecraft. Some of the greatest writers and directors will admit to drawing some sort of influence in one way or another with the writings of H.P. Lovecraft. Born in the late 1800s and raised in a very ethnocentric bubble in Providence, Rhode Island, Lovecraft lived an almost tragic life. Raised by an eccentric mother who showed no affection to him as a child, had rendered him socially inept, and had no friends, he began to retreat to his grandfather's vast library of books that had been written almost 2 centuries earlier.
Which had an obvious influence on him and his writing style.
Lovecraft has had an influence on horror creators of all sorts,
probably a little more than they care to admit.
The author H.P. Lovecraft, although a hugely influential author,
was also unfortunately kind of the product of his own environment.
His secluded lifestyle and very archaic way of thinking, he expressed on many occasions very ethnocentric and xenophobic views of society.
I mean, he was a pretty messed up dude, and I think he knew it. He showed it in the way he wrote and the way he talked very often.
The idea or narrative of a dark side or shadow self that resides in all human beings, which is both a common theme in almost all of Lovecraft's work, as well as most of those influenced by him. A dark underworld relentlessly trying to break through to our side and consisted of unimaginable creatures that did not care for us one bit.
And I mean, you see this in everything, and it's very prevalent in this movie.
When it starts to reveal that everything someone reads in a Sutter Kane novel begins to become reality, a darker side or version of what is read unfolds. The undertone of people giving in to the norm and letting it change them. The lead character is a skeptic to the near end when he finally starts to realize that he himself is nothing but a fictional character written into Kane's novel. As he tries to escape Kane's fictional town, he is repeatedly caught in a loop.
The same as the kid on the bicycle earlier in the movie that loops into an old man.
The original script was written to end with the whole town being swallowed up by blackness, but budget restraints forced them to change it to the tearing of reality scene followed by Trent watching himself as a character on the big screen.
Which once again, in classic Carpenter fashion, leaves a little gray area for interpretation and for discussion. Okay, this movie is awesome and severely slept on. I mean, it's gaining a kind of a cult following now, but it did really, really bad at the box office. And some people kind of say that this is Carpenter's last great film. It's the last real Carpenter film. The few movies he did after, he felt he had not enough creative control and too much restraint from the studios, which kind of eventually made him want to leave Hollywood. In the Mouth of Madness. Watch it, enjoy it, talk about it. And I don't know, I mean, have you seen the movie? Let me know in the comments what you think about it. I would love to go more in depth on this movie especially, but I have to kind of keep this kind of short. If you enjoyed this video, please give it a thumbs up. And as always, thank you for watching, and we will catch you on the flippy flip. Peace.
Whoa, we're not talking about reality here. We're talking about fiction. It's different, you know?
A reality is just what we tell each other it is. Sane and insane could easily switch places if the insane were to become the majority. You would find yourself locked in a padded cell, wondering what happened to the world.